Two.
Oh, where am I? Oh, right, I'm doing a podcast. Hey, everybody, welcome to the H3 Podcast. I am the Fresh Prince of Dead Air. Thank you to MeUndies for sponsoring this episode. With me is my beautiful co-host, Ela Klein. You guys know her, you love her. With us today is Tim Dillon, one of the funniest guys around right now. I love him. I love everything he does. He's funny. Everything he says is funny. His mannerisms are funny. And everything's funny about him. Also, he's a comedian, incidentally, which is good because he's funny. Tim, what's going on?
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it. Those mannerisms don't work in any other job.
Right.
I've tried many. There have been many. I thought I was going to be a really good salesman. And I thought, because I have like kind of a sales look and voice. Mm. And I thought that was going to work. That did not work. So thank God that I found a place, you know, wearing wigs and yelling and screaming at people and podcasting and doing all the things that I do. Thank God that it all comes together and works.
Thank God for that, right? I feel like I had the same problems in life, you know? So how are you feeling? What's going on? I appreciate, first of all, you being in a studio and having proper audio. We had our friends Tom and Christina who Skyped in the other day without headphones or a mic, and they thought that was appropriate.
Yeah, well, you know, ban them, truly. Yeah. I mean, that's going to teach people a lesson, is to just kind of ban them, I think. I'm on a little mini tour of America right now doing stand-up comedy in socially distanced clubs where we're taking every precaution. We're trying to be safe. We're masking up. We're in the green rooms. We're trying to keep everybody out of the green. You know, the owners of all these clubs, they just come in the green room anyway, and they no mask. They just start talking about, like, you know,
really?
Bill Hicks or whatever war stories that no one cares about. And it's like, I have to throw them out. I have to go, can you please get out of here? You know, and I like these people, you know, and I appreciate them, but it's just enough's enough. And it's weird because, you know, I was looking at the guy who opens for me, you know, Trump went to the hospital, and I said, dude, the president could die while we are on stage tonight. Mm. I'm like,
That's wild.
One of the craziest times to do stand-up comedy, I think maybe ever. I'm like, you know, we have riots, we have civil unrest, we have a president infected with a novel coronavirus. No one knows how anyone responds to it. He's in the hospital right now. He's tweeting from a hospital bed that New York and California are going to hell.
Right.
I mean, and we're on stage right now, and every audience right now is it's like, you know, somebody used the words and I forget, but it was like a psychological crime scene where you don't know what you're going to get. You have hardcore Trump people. You have people that think Trump's the devil. You have people that hate the whole thing and don't want to hear one word about politics.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And then you have and then you pour alcohol on all of that for an hour, and then I get on a stage, and it's a really wild tour. And we're touring up until about a week or two after the election, and then hopefully maybe I'll tape something and put it out, maybe not. And then we're kind of shutting down for a little while, hibernating for the winter, podcasting, hibernating, and then seeing, hopefully, you know, if we can get through this, whatever a second wave looks like, and then maybe get back out in the spring.
Have you had any bad shows where people are like, we don't like that? Those political jokes.
You know, we've had shows where people are just very, like, you know, they're on the brink. They haven't been out of their home in 5 months. They've been, you know, holed up with their wife and children, you know, and they're really, like, socially, they forgot how to behave. Now, most people don't know how to behave in a comedy club anyway. Now, this is people that have just forgot how to behave. They don't know how to, like, I go, no, we can't do the meet and greet. So a guy tries to get on stage and go, can I take a photo with you on stage? I'm like, no,
oh,
this
God.
Is wildly inappropriate. We can't do that. So, yeah, people are, I've had a guy, and what am I? I'm a comedian, right? I'm not, you know, who cares? But, like, I had a guy chase me across the stage, him and his girlfriend, running across, like, a 4-lane highway with an iPhone going, we got to take a picture. And I'm like, guys, like, it looks bad for the club. Like, the club is trying to do this by the book. We can all make money and work. It looks horrible. If I'm, and listen, friends of mine, you know, Brandon Schaub was a cool dude, funny guy. He got COVID and they were doing meet and greets. And it's like, you know, nothing looks worse than
that is not good.
Instagram and going, by the way, anyone that touched my hand, oh, you my might want to get tested.
General announcements to all my fans.
Right.
Is there anything more unfunny for a comedian?
Yeah. Oh, by the way, I hope you guys enjoyed my set. Little footnote.
It was weird. It was basically like, hey, guys, I hope it was worth it because it might be the last thing you see.
Well, it's kind of funny because you go ahead.
I was going to say, you're talking about how, like, this is for some people, this is the first time they're going out after 5 months. That was exactly my experience when Whitney invited me to her open closed mic event in her backyard at the house. And I got to see you there. And that was my first time leaving the house to do anything since COVID hit. Like, other than work.
The best audience member by far. I mean, you got all the jokes. I mean, listen, I love the Instagram influencer community. I don't know that there's a huge overlap in what I do and what they do. But God bless all of them. But these are not they're not my demo of people, truly. And I don't know that their humor is what their, I don't know if that's their, you know, thing. Like, I don't know how much they like humor. There was a lot of like people sitting there, like they found the idea of it interesting. They were like, this is an interesting idea that this guy is saying things that are funny, and they would smile and everything. But you really like listened and got jokes, and that was very helpful.
I loved it so much. Like, first of all, just being out was so weird all of a sudden. And then your jokes were, you crushed it, first of all.
Thank you.
But also the topics were just so funny, like making fun of like the nurses thinking they're heroes. It's like, okay, let's, or like the Postmate drivers being heroes now. It's like, okay, let's step back. You're still just a driver.
Yeah. Well, I think that's part of what we got to do now is release the tension, right? There's a lot of tension everywhere. So part of what we got to do is like have fun. My comedy is a little whatever, darker. You know, it's, you know, I like the type of comedy where it's like, you got to be really funny about it. Cause if not, people are going to be like, hey, why are you saying that?
Yeah.
So it's just funny. I'm always kidding. It's a joke. And everybody that walks to a comedy club gets that. And, you know, and it's really fun. And we had a great time that night. That was like one of my first times doing stand up back, you know, and Whitney was really cool. Whitney, you know, put that whole thing together in our backyard. And I think she caught a little flack for it. People were like, oh, what are you doing? But like everybody got tested. Everybody was outside. Everybody was, I mean, we're doing all the things that you can humanly do here to try to make, I have a gnat just flew into my face. My friends came to my house the other day. I rented a house in the desert for coronavirus out in Palm Springs. And my friend and his wife are very healthy. And every time, like, can I get you guys anything? They always request fruit because I think they think that I don't have any produce or fruit. So they think it's just pints of ice cream. So they're like, can you please get fruit? Like his wife yells in the background, can he get fruit for us? And then they eat half the fruit and then it rots. And then we have like flies that come in, like gnats.
Yeah.
And I feel like I'm in like a bodega with like rotten fruit.
Dude, these fruit flies are kind of incredible because I swear to God, you could be in a hermetically sealed room.
They somehow get
and
there.
And the flies will get in there on the fruit.
I hate them. And
it's really crazy.
I don't get half fruit people. Like,
you can't eat.
You can't eat half and put it back.
That's like a cardinal sin.
I feel like I see it in America a lot. Like I don't think in Israel people do that.
My mom's a huge criminal.
If you didn't finish it, throw it out. Like we'll get another apple. We'll get another banana.
She eat half the banana. She put it back in the basket.
Yeah.
She does that every time she comes.
This couple, I mean, I do like them, but they're animals, you know? And you know, I invited them to my home. They call me. This is during Corona. This is a fact. During Corona, they go like this. I'm sitting. I get a whole lunch platter for us, a whole thing, a shrimp cocktail. I'm like ridiculous. And I'm like sitting there waiting for them to get there. And they call me. They go, we're still about an hour out. I said, okay, we left at the same time. They go, we're at the outlets.
The outlets. That's my parents.
What kind of disgusting human being? I have a lunch. I have a pool. We're supposed to be having a day. You're trying on clothes in a pandemic?
At the outlets?
That's crazy. You should unfriend them.
It's crazy.
Did you yell at them or did you just let it slide?
You know, I let it slide and then I trash them on my podcast.
Yeah, that's great.
And then they listen to it. That's the way I communicate. I really trash them. And they just had a baby, you know, and I'm like, I hope it's taken by the state and everything. So I really just kind of hammered home what unfit parents they were and how disgusting as friends. And I mean, it's crazy. So that's what I do. That's how I get back at people.
So you seem to have a lot of thoughts about everything that's going on. You do seem very politically engaged. You have a lot of opinions about stuff. So I was thinking I'll ask you on some topics, and I want to get your true unfettered thoughts.
Yes.
Okay, here we go. The 2020 election, how are we looking as a country?
We're not looking good as a country. I mean, it's looking, I'm 35 years old. I didn't live through Vietnam. I didn't live through, Martin Luther King's assassination. I did not live through, anything that I have lived through, this has felt the most contentious anything has ever been. It feels like we are heading towards, and we've already seen violence, which I think is like, once chaos is unleashed and violence, you know, violence justifies more violence. And that to me is terrifying. And when people in the country that come from different political viewpoints see each other as enemies and they see each other as basically irredeemable, right?
Yeah.
We are looking at a political philosophy right now and saying this is irredeemable. People that voted for Trump are irredeemable, or people that like Ocasio-Cortez are irredeemable for whatever reason. So I think we're in a very bad place. I think social media and technology, this is really maybe the first two elections where you've seen the impact of social media have this truly transformative effect on not only how we process information, but, you know, what is and isn't real. You know, we're creating these bubbles and worlds that don't exist. So, I mean, my thing is like, I don't think Trump has done a good job. I don't think Trump, if you looked at the facts, I don't think Trump deserves to win again. I think it would be better to have a reset. Mm-hmm. That being said, I do feel like the Democrats chose a candidate who's particularly weak and not exciting. I do think the vice president that they chose is more exciting than him. But I don't know that anybody running right now has my confidence that they're going to. We need a transformative figure. We need a JFK type figure. I don't think anybody running is that person. And I don't even know if that person would be able to do what really needs to be done. But I think if you had a truly transformative figure, there might be, we need a period of time where we can kind of put things back together. I don't know. I think that another 4 years of Trump, you're looking at 4 years of just what we've gotten, you know, 4 years, you're another 4 years of that. And then if you get, you know, Biden and Kamala, I think you're getting at a very Washington, very kind of optics, aesthetic based politics. Mm-hmm. I don't know how much that's going to help people. I think it's going to be, which is Obama, who's a brilliant guy. But I think the reason that you have, one of the big reasons that you have Trump is that it was so powerful to see Obama win. It was so important for the country to see a black man elected president. And he tried to do a lot of great stuff, but the system is so big and so broken that a lot of people over those 8 years, their lives got worse. Their lives got, and they felt ignored. And they became angry and they became enraged. And a lot of that rage got Donald Trump was really good at directing that rage, you know? So I think if you have Biden and Harris, it might be a better option. Even just selfishly, because I just want people to kind of just shut up and fake activism is annoying to me. And the clearly, you know, the social media activism and the BLM shirts where it's like your revolution should not have merch. That's the first thing. It should not have merch. Like a revolution shouldn't have a merch drop. That's just not no. what a political thing should have. So I think there's valid points that they all make. I think BLM makes valid points. I think a lot of people make valid points. But everything in this society is it's all optics. It's all look at me and look at what I'm doing. And very little work actually gets done. So my fear with Biden, with Harris, is that you're going to get just kind of the same lip service. I don't know that there's going to be anything meaningfully changed. And then you get another Trump. And then we just kind of yin and yang back and forth to really bad places.
I think that's why people kind of also were more supportive of Trump during the last election, because I think people were hoping he was that guy because he was like, he's an outsider. He doesn't play by the rules and this and that.
Yeah. But successful business. Man.
I love it.
But I think what I'm hoping is that Biden wins. And then the problem is, like, I was listening to Obama on a podcast yesterday. It was really interesting because he was saying he tried to do so much progressive stuff, but there's so many ways to obstruct it in our government. Like the filibuster is just such a pointless tool to block any movement. So he's saying, like, you know, if the Democrats take control, we need to get rid of all this
procedural.
Just procedural obstructions before anything can get done.
Well, it's a very divided country, right? And you have this idea that no matter what issue you put up there, whether it's guns, whether it's whatever, you're going to have roughly half the country agreeing with you, half the country disagreeing with you. So you don't want judicial fiat. You don't want courts necessarily or judges being able to legislate every aspect of people's lives. You want the president to kind of be constrained. You don't want an executive branch that can, I mean, the scope of presidential power since George W. Bush, even before that, but really intensifying then, has gotten so big. Mm-hmm. I mean, you know, I love that Obama said that. I would love to hear him say, I also should not be able to conduct an extrajudicial drone war with my CIA without the American public really signing off on it, without Congress, you know, basically just being able to prosecute a war using highly advanced weaponry in parts of the world, lots of collateral damage, lots of blowback, lots of innocent civilians killed. So the power that the president has to do things like that, I think, are a huge problem, right? Mm-hmm. And a lot of people would feel that way. They would go, yeah, I completely understand that. As somebody who wanted to do more, he was frustrated, but he was able to do a lot that I don't think a president should have been able to do, you know, without more procedure. You know, it's like, so when all these guys, you know, anybody who's had that job, they usually go, I hate there's too many procedures. I just can't get anything done. This guy's filibustering me. They got this Congress. It's all these people. And I was like, yeah, but it's kind of supposed to be like that because they find ways around those procedures a lot. And I mean, so again, it's also, it's like you travel around America. Here's what's interesting about America. You travel around as a comedian and you look at it. And I think to myself sometimes, I'm like, why would this be a country? Like if you just landed here and went around America and then at the end of it, explained that this was one country,
right?
People would be shocked.
Yeah. It's so
people
big.
Stunned.
And diverse, that this too.
One country where everybody has to get on the same page about everything. I mean, it's like my aunt, who's, you know, on Percocet drunk, you know, on Facebook right now, you know, talking about, you know, trade or whatever, you know, China's coming to kill her in the middle of the night and Trump's the only one that's going to save her. I have to somehow get my aunt on the same page as, you know, somebody in Portland with blue hair who's burning down a federal courthouse. That's tough. All right. Now, they're the same person, truly, my aunt and that figure, gender not specific, unimportant person burning down the court. Her and my aunt are the same person.
Yeah.
Someone who needs help.
Yeah.
But we have to politically put them in a box and find, like, what do we agree on, folks? That's very difficult.
Yeah, that's a great point.
So true. I think
the country has just kind of been fractured ever since, you know, its inception in the Civil War. We're still dealing with the same kind of stuff that we have been dealing, you know, since then. The repercussions of having a constitution that by its architecture discriminates against, you know,
democracy is also just a tough one. Yeah. Democracy is a tough one.
It is. It wouldn't be so much better. Just so much easier.
Yeah, go and meet the people. I don't even know if people want it, to be honest. Like, I think if you brought back a monarchy, I don't even know if they want democracy. Like, I don't know. Go and meet the people and ask them what they really want the responsibility. I don't think they do. I think it would shock you. Let's put democracy on the ballot. I think we can get rid of it this election pretty quickly.
Just fuck this.
Yeah, I think people will be like, we've had enough. We don't want to do it. Cancel the news. I don't think people care. Right. If people traffic in weather, give them stuff that affects them. Let them know when we're in a war. Let them know when they have to put the garbage out on Tuesday. I think people are fed up because, like, the things that people are mad, now people are mad about Biden's son in the Ukraine.
Yeah.
People don't know what the Ukraine is, and now they have fully formed opinion. Right. And I'm not saying Biden's son's not shady, but it's like, I look at people in my life. I was a cocaine addict when I was a child, when I was in my teens, right? Wow. And I know that you look at me now, you're like, oh my God, you bounced back. But when I was in my teens,
that's an expensive habit for a young man.
It is,
but I stole.
Okay, good.
All of the people that sold me cocaine are now deeply Christian conservatives.
Oh.
Conspiracy theories like QAnon and stuff.
Wow.
And I'm like, I did cocaine with you when I was 14.
Right.
And now you're talking about family values on Facebook.
That's so interesting.
Yeah. And so these are the people. I mean, these are the people out there that need to be governed. It's like, it's not going to be pretty. It's just not going to be pretty. I don't know what to tell anyone.
You know,
I
feel like enough people would read Brave New World today and be like, that sounds good.
Sounds great.
It doesn't sound that bad.
I'm ready for the tech prison. And I think most people are.
Like, yeah. I mean, Brave New World, they're just high on like MDMA all day and they just fucking zone out. And that sounds like my ideal afternoon.
I think that's exactly what it's going to be. And I think that's fine. And we're lucky to have it. I mean, listen, I mean, it's going to be what it is. You know, I travel around and I meet people. There's some brilliant people in this country. There's some beautiful people in this country. And there are some people in this country who truly should not be allowed to have any type of opinion. I mean, they shouldn't.
Yeah.
They just shouldn't be allowed. And they are. They're allowed. They're allowed. So, I mean, I don't know what to tell you, but it's not going to work out well. I just look at it out there and I go, we're in, now you guys have kids, of course, and it's like, I get it. When you have kids, you got to be like, you got to stay positive and it'll be fine for them. You guys have done well. But for most people out there, it's just going to get harder. I think it is just going to get harder to have the type of life you want to have.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So tell me about how do you feel that it's going with COVID? How is the world doing with COVID?
We've gotten to a point with COVID now where I don't even know anymore what's happened. Like, I don't even understand what's going on. And it's the cases are up, they're down, we're open, we're not.
Yeah.
I don't know why businesses don't have, like, I was at the Beverly Hills Hotel and they're like, we don't have calamari. And I said, why? And the guy's like, well, you know, because of COVID. I said, I'm going to bite you in the face because this is a lie. You're lying to the people. And I don't like this idea that all businesses are like open at 30% of like trying. None of these, like, you stay in a hotel now, they don't send the maid to the room. Nothing is done. We're just a lazy, slovenly pig country now because of coronavirus. It's like, well, then shut it down. What are we doing? I mean, Disney World and Universal, they're opened up. Do the roller coasters just go up and then down and not through the whole thing? I think we open or we don't. I think it's smart to wear the masks. It's smart to do the distancing. There is no credibility. Trump is not credible. Fauci is not credible. He threw that ball. I mean, he looked like he had like a spinal injury.
The ball, the Fauci's first pitch ruined his credibility.
Oh, the ball.
Yeah. It's also like Fauci is not the name of a doctor.
Can you pull that up?
Get a Asian doctor. Get a Jewish doctor.
Can we pull up the Fauci first pitch?
The name of a guy who runs a neighborhood eatery that you enjoy. It's not, I think those things matter.
So I'm going to pull up Fauci's first pitch and so the people can see. So this is the moment when Dr. Fauci lost all credibility. Here it is. This is the worst pitch since Baba Booey, they say.
To throw out this ceremony.
Gary Delabate. That was pretty brutal, man. I got to say, if you throw a ball like that, you really shouldn't be out there.
You shouldn't be out there. The people in charge of public health in this country look horrific. The woman in LA is like, she's an albino. She's pale. She comes out, she has white hair.
What was that?
Fauci, come on, man.
It's bad.
Yeah. So
what was that?
Yeah, we're hopeless. If that's our public health expert, you can't even throw fastball.
People come out and they're like gremlins, and they come out to the mic and they're like, "No tennis." Back and you're like, "Okay, what are we doing?"
Did you ever get an explanation how calamari is connected to COVID?
No, they don't. They don't get. They just go, "Well, it's a new COVID. No, we just can't do anything." All the restaurants I go to, there's problems on the menu. There's issues. We can't do this. We can't do that. The tuna tartare because of COVID. Blah, blah, blah.
It seems like a lot of your problems with COVID are connected to food. Is that right?
Of course they are because I demand excellence. Yeah. I should be, and because I care about the restaurants and the servers and the staff, and that's why I correct them and get a little rough with them. If I wasn't a little, some would say abusive to them, they're not going to be as good at their jobs. They're not going to make the money. Yeah. So at the end of the day, it's like, you know, and I get it. Boa Steakhouse, everyone in there is more famous to me. They're all 15. They all have Lamborghinis. I've ordered the steak rare. Can it come rare? I know that you're picking people up off the floor and putting them in G wagons and dealing with overdoses, but I'm still a customer here. That's what I'm saying.
So if they overcook it, you order a rare steak and it comes medium, it's the COVID.
Everything's COVID. Well, because of COVID, you know, it's coronavirus, it's a pandemic. I've literally had people look at me and go, "That's a pandemic." I said, "I'm going to jump over the table if you say that again." You know, during Hurricane Sandy, this happened in Long Island. All my friends from Long Island are all losers. And Hurricane Sandy was the greatest thing that ever happened, because for the next 5 years, they walked around and they're like, "The Hurricane Sandy, I was working towards something." And it's, no, you weren't, you know? Working towards anything. But so this is my thing. It's like, I think they're getting better at treating it. There's a cocktail of remdesivir and the convalescent plasma that seems to be working. I spoke to a doctor today that seems to be doing better. I think they're getting better at identifying and treating it. Hopefully testing gets better.
Right.
Hopefully we're able to kind of, there are no good options here. You can lock everything down and save every life at the expense of the economy and people's personal freedom. There's no real good options. I think what you need is credibility. I think you need, a new face. I think Fauci it'd be good to get just a new face in here.
Someone who can
just
pitch a ball, face. Right?
I also don't need him on every podcast. Like, he went out to do every podcast.
He does podcasts?
He does a lot of every media. Pod-
what?
Yeah, he does a lot of media.
Like, I don't need.
How do they have time for that?
That's what he does.
I don't need a public health guy on My Favorite Murder. Just get in a lab and get the vaccine now. I mean, he's giving awards out. Didn't he give an award out?
What?
He gave an award. There was a digital, what was it? It was the MTV Music Awards, Ben. Whatever it was, he gave an award
really?
Out. It really was, to me, it's unprofessional. And I don't love him. And I think that somebody, I don't know what he gave an award out for, but I know he was a presenter, or maybe he gave like a little speech or something.
Wait, I got to see that. I got to pull that up now because I didn't know that. I
mean, what's next? He's going to wear off-white?
Was it the MTV Music Awards? He did something.
Presents.
Might have been MTV Music Awards. He like gave a little
man, talk. Let's see. A Webby Award?
Webby Award.
I fucking hate the Webbies, dude.
Yeah, so Fauci's out there giving out Webbies, and we've got a pandemic.
Okay, I'm gonna watch this. I gotta know what the fuck? Webbies from home.
Oh my God.
Greetings.
My name
greetings.
Is Dr. Tony Fauci, and I am here to present some good news at a time of great stress as we struggle to contain the COVID-19 outbreak.
By the way, just so you know, this Facebook page, The Webby Awards, this video has 768 views.
Nice.
After 5 months. So
time well spent.
Find those people and experimentally vaccinate them.
Many young people.
Let's see what he's presenting.
Up and helped us throughout this difficult time. The 24th annual Webby Awards will honor Avi Shipman.
24th? Has the internet even been out that long? The 24th? There's too many Webby Awards.
2020 Person of the Year in recognition of his creation of nCoV2019.
This is so unexciting.
To track the spread of COVID-19
this is the worst thing I've ever seen, you're
across
right,
the world.
Tim.
As we collectively navigate the severe impact.
Bro, just
COVID-19.
Call the fucking
can
war,
you just
man.
Not do this?
But critical calls for nationwide social
I hate this so
distancing.
Much.
The internet has become the lifeblood.
Give the award, asshole.
Information about the novel coronavirus and the necessary steps to combat it. Since launching the site on December 29th...
Oh, my God. He keeps going. Care systems, I'm skipping forward. I just want to cut...
...shift then as the 2020 Webby Person of the Year.
So who won?
Abby Schiffman.
What the fuck is that? Bro, that is the worst thing I've ever seen. You're right.
Congrats, Abby. That was very exciting.
Couldn't he have done something bigger like Vlogger of the Year or something? Give him something. You know what I mean? Let him do something
bigger.
How about
the best super spreading influencer?
Yeah, right.
There's a lot of good competition in that category.
Yeah, I mean,
Jake Paul infected 200 people. The hype
house. I
feel like
everyone in the orbits of those guys, you know the risks you're taking, you know?
That's a very good point.
I think you know the risks you're taking. I just think
that's a really good point, yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know if you've seen, there's this one guy, this one YouTuber who got COVID, and he was hanging out with Jake Paul, and he goes, hey, Jake, have you seen this?
I don't think I have,
So funny. He goes, hey, Jake, he's recording him candidly, and Jake doesn't know. So he calls him, he goes, hey, Jake, I have COVID. And he's like, yeah, I don't really give a fuck. That's it. That's all I said. Oh, yeah, we have the soundbite. Go ahead, Zach.
We don't care.
Yeah, we don't care. And that was it.
I kind of respect the attitude. Those guys, they exercise a lot. That's part of their thing. They're in good shape. I think part of that training all the time is to be like, hey, yeah, fuck the coronavirus. You know, like, we don't care. Come over here and it's all good. I mean, I got to be a little more careful. But
that's
those
what
guys
I was going to say, because guys like me and you, you know.
Be a little careful.
Yeah. Because are you scared of getting COVID?
I'm not scared. I don't want it.
Yeah, I don't want it.
I don't want it. I don't know that it's running. I don't know that the fear is running my life. But I mean, listen, man, if I look like Jake Paul, I would absolutely not care, probably.
Yeah.
I'd be like, yeah, fuck that. But now, you know, I'm 35. You know, I'm in a high risk group. I don't know what that even means. The survival rate's very high. I mean, I know that people have long-term effects. They can't run marathons or stuff like that. And that would hurt me if I couldn't continue to push triathlons and things that bring me joy. Yeah. But I mean, I don't want it. And I don't want to give it to anyone. I don't want any of my fans getting it. So it's like, I just say, come to the shows, do the distancing, sit at the table they put you at. Don't do the meet and greets. Like, and also, if you can't come this time, I totally get that too. Like, we're selling out shows. Like, people are really excited to be out of the house. But like, come next time. Like, if you can't be there, if you're compromised, whatever, I totally get it. And we'll see you next time. No big deal. Just, you know, just support the podcast, buy our products, and, you know, support us in other ways, please. But if you can't show up,
Tim Dillon show, by the way.
Oh, thank you. Yeah.
YouTube, great podcast. One of the great ones. I'm going to take a quick break to thank our sponsors, buy our products.
Good.
And we'll be back right after this quick 2-minute break. MeUndies, guys, let's be honest, it's the best underwear in the game. It's so soft, it's breathable, it's made out of micromodal, which I frankly don't even know what it is, but apparently it's some space age technology that just means it's soft and breathable, better than cotton. I've grown up with the same underwear for like 20 years, and it just disintegrates, and it feels awful. And I think it's time that we all get on this MeUndie train and upgrade our underwear game. They've even got new Halloween prints. Check it out. We got cats, blood, skeletons, everything that's up your haunted alley. I'm fat. I've got a huge waist. What I love about MeUndies, besides the fact that it's like soft and breathable and wonderful, it doesn't chafe my fat fucking hips. You know? It feels good. Their undies, they grow on trees. They're made from soft, natural fibers, beechwood trees. That's crazy. Micromodal, as I mentioned, it's not only super soft, but breathable, light, and impossibly cozy. Seriously comfortable. Everything MeUndie does is to help you feel comfortable from head to toe, from outside to in. How are they going to make me feel comfortable inside my body? I like that product because I need help in that department. You also have MeUndies memberships. Never run out of undies with MeUndies membership, a subscription that sends new pairs right to your door. Because who really wants to grab that questionable 6-pack of underwear at your local drugstore? That's what I've been wearing my whole life. MeUndies changed the game for me. Plus, get site-wide savings and exclusive sales. But they've got a special offer for our fans here right now today. MeUndies has a great offer for any first-time purchase. You get 15% off and free shipping. MeUndies also has their problem-free philosophy. If you're not satisfied with any product for any reason, you get a refund or an exchange. No questions asked. No strings attached. So if you want 15% off your first order and free shipping, go to MeUndies.com/H3. That's MeUndies.com/H3. Back with Tim Dillon, Epstein. What do we think about Epstein?
Hey, good guy.
Good guy. One of the best guys. I wish he was running for president.
I mean, like, let's just leave it there.
Is he could have been the change we need in 2020.
Yeah. I mean, Ghislaine Maxwell, Epstein. I mean, yeah, I don't know. Nothing comes out about that. I think, I mean, I think there's probably a lot of very powerful people. I know that there's a lot of very powerful people implicated. They're not going to see any type of justice, I would imagine. I would guess.
Well, they got to him, man. It was crazy how they got to him, right? Like, yeah. There's no way. I'm so not a conspiracy theorist. Like,
yeah.
Yeah.
That one tests the people that it aren't does.
That one
theorists.
Really tests you.
And that one tests me, you know. I'm like, yeah. Dude, you know, there's just no way that dude wasn't murdered. There's just no way.
No, I think he was either killed or he was allowed to kill himself.
Right.
I think he was involved with intelligence people and, you know, I mean, those guys, whether it's CIA or Mossad or MI6 or any of these intelligence agencies, I mean, that's kind of the way it ends when you're a spy or when you're doing stuff like that, right? When you're blackmailing people or entrapping people or whatever, you know, it ends bad, right? When you live the life of a spy.
You think he was an asset?
I would imagine he was.
That kind of makes sense, right? Why he's not been brought in earlier.
I think he's just blackmailing people and getting information on powerful people. I think he was what they call like an access agent where if you access,
very powerful. I haven't thought about that.
Mm. Yeah, I think that was what he was doing. And I think Ghislaine Maxwell's father was an intelligence guy and Maxwell and her family, that was kind of the family business. I mean, this is just, it's maybe shocking or new to people, but if you've read books about this type of stuff, it's not that new. Like, this is just what the CIA did. By the way, before that, the mafia did it, where the mafia would entrap people and, you know, set you up with a woman and then photograph it and then go, like, we can destroy your family or you can pay me money.
Well, that's what they say. The Russians have some kind of dirt like that on Trump. I mean, who knows? That's pretty...
It's interesting. I don't know if that's true or not. There's so much weird disinfo about that Russia story. You have no idea. Because you have so many interested parties that are very capable of crafting a narrative, right? Sure. Trump's people... the CIA, or the national security apparatus, you know, people in there, you know, when they call it the deep state, obviously the deep state has now become anyone that criticizes Trump. But the deep state is just a nexus of powerful institutions that are largely unelected. They're appointed. Mm-hmm. They have their career, you know, diplomats and people like that. And it's just power factions in Washington. And they all have interests. They all have budgets. They all compete over money. They compete over territory. They compete over all kinds of things. And, you know, those are deep-seated animosity that they have towards certain people or policies, and they have all kinds of ways of getting rid of those people and policies and all kinds of ways of propping up people and policies that they like. Mm-hmm. So there is this kind of underground institutional war that's happening not only now but forever with power players and power factions in D.C. and all over the world. And, you know, it's a very interesting, and I love that stuff. I find it very, very interesting.
I like the way you explain it because it doesn't sound like so much of a conspiracy theory as just kind of an actual general notion that makes sense when you explain it like that.
Yeah.
I think Trump ruined the expression deep state, like you kind of touched on.
Well, because it, you know, basically as soon as you start putting stuff on shirts and making it like, you know, it's no longer a working theory that makes a lot of sense to people. And it's just such a great, like, you know, deep state, fake news, all these things. You say fake news to anyone that criticizes you, it loses, you know, you lose the idea that the media does have credibility issues, right? Mm-hmm. The media is, it's a for-profit enterprise. They want to make money. They want eyeballs. They want viewers. They sensationalize things. They don't do a lot of work. Investigative journalism's almost dead. They don't spend the time and money marshaling resources, building relationships, sourcing and investigating things the way they should. They rush to press with a lot of highly sensationalized, maybe true, maybe not information. And it guarantees them, you know, the eyeballs that they want and the clicks and everything like that. That's not to say that every criticism of Trump and his administration is pretend or made up or, but you know, what he's really brilliant at is taking something with nuggets of truth mm-hmm. and kernels of truth and twisting it around so that it serves him exclusively, mm-hmm. which is kind of a brilliant mm-hmm. way to do it. He finds these things where he goes, yeah, fake news, they're fake news. And it's like, people are like, well, yeah, the media, you don't love the media. So what he does is he kind of turns things on their axis so that they serve him.
Yeah, he is a brilliant propagandist for sure. But like, what's going on with Ghislaine? Is that her name, Ghislaine? I find that funny. Her name's Jiz.
Ghislaine?
Because at first I was like, oh, it's Gazelle or something, like French name.
I've heard it pronounced Ghislaine.
It's Ghislaine, yeah. She's just in jail. What's going on? Why aren't we squeezing her like a goddamn...
I think what's going to happen, Ghislaine is charged with a few counts. They're not... It's a certain period of time. She's been charged within a few-year period. It's not this wide-ranging... Unless something changes and there's subsequent indictments, what she's charged with is actually, it's disturbing, of course. It's, you know, transporting minors for solicitation or whatever. But I don't think she is not charged of molesting anyone, even though she's accused of it.
Well,
credibly.
I don't know if you've seen. Yeah. Did you see that documentary? Was it on Netflix?
Yeah.
That was very disturbing, man.
It's wild. But she's probably going to get whatever a slap on the wrist is. Maybe it's 5 years. Maybe it's not. Really? You know, maybe she'll give up a few names. Maybe she won't. I don't think she's giving up anybody big.
Really?
I think she takes it to the grave. I think that's what she's trained to do. I think that's what her dad did. That's what Epstein did. I think when you're in that line of work, you're in that business. It's a business. I mean, I hate to say it. It sounds horrible. It's a business. It's like anything else. It's like comedy. If you're a comedian, there's rules and codes, you know, whatever. If you're whatever you do, and I think in their world, the code is like you kind of take it to the grave.
Wow.
Or in 2 years, she's on The View talking about that she
manipulated funny. I saw by Michael a powerful Cohen. Man.
And Joy Behar's like, you tell him, you go, girl. You know, who knows? I don't know.
I love that. I saw Michael Cohen on CNN. Like shitting on Trump. And I was like, this is so bizarre. This is just so odd. You ever seen
this? They just want, you know, I mean, Trump's goon squad is one of the funnier collections of human beings. Everybody from, you know, Anthony Scaramucci and Steve Bannon and Kellyanne Conway. I mean, it really is a squad of goons that I find kind of enjoyable. You know, these are the people that I used to sell subprime mortgages with. Now they're running it's phenomenal.
You know, it reminds me when you say that, like, there's a code, it's a business. There's this guy on TikTok who I follow who's really good. He just goes up to people in really expensive cars and he asks what they do for a living. And he usually shocks the hell out of them, too. So it starts like this, like, oh!
Yeah.
But I imagine him going up to Ghislaine and being like, what do you do for a living? She's like, I sex traffic kids.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. And then he just goes, thank you very much. That's it. That's it all.
And I think, by the way, in the 90s, she would have said that. Like, I think now with the internet, without the internet, like, I think she would have been kind of polite. She's like, I'll throw parties for people that really want to have sex with children, love. And he's like, all right.
Thank you very much. Have a good day.
I think if you went back to, like, the 70s, somebody would be like, all right, hey, have a nice day. Nice car. But,
yeah.
I mean, the idea that children should be protected, it obviously, to us, is all second nature. It makes a lot of sense. But throughout history, I mean, it just hasn't been the case, right? From the church to, like, you know, workhouses and all the horrible things children have gone through. But I think the Epstein thing is interesting. My favorite take, by the way, was when he was killed. Everybody was like, you know, I've lived in New York City my whole life. Now I'm in LA for the last 3 years, but 2 years, whatever. And then, but my favorite take was, like, when he died, everybody was like, how did they outsmart the corrections officers?
Yeah.
How were they able? How were these intelligence agencies, kings, queens, and presidents, able to formulate a plan that outsmarted my friend Giacomo, who was the corrections officer in New York City? Everybody was like, I just can't believe it. I'm like, I don't know. Maybe they told him Derek Jeter was downstairs. Like, I bet it was a relatively easy part of the plan.
How do you like LA? How long have you been in LA?
I've been in here. How long have I been here? My producer knows. Year and a half full time, but I was on and off for a year before that.
Do you hate LA? Because I feel like I don't know. I feel like everybody hates LA outside of LA. Have you noticed that phenomenon?
No, I don't hate it, but I think it's silly. And I like that it's silly, right? Mm-hmm. I like it. It's fun to make fun of. You know, my friend Joe Rogan just moved to Texas and he's, you know, he loves it there and he's telling everyone. And, you know, maybe down the road, but like right now I'm kind of happy in LA. I think it's crazy. Mm-hmm. I think it's funny. I think as the world's ending, it is appropriate that there are millionaire children dancing on balconies of homes. Yeah. I think that's great. I think that,
that it's great that the best
restaurant in LA is the Saddle Ranch, which serves chicken fingers in a parking lot. Mm. I think it's all, you know, exactly what it should be, a completely ridiculous, somewhat embarrassing place. It's embarrassing if you don't throw yourself into it, which I throw myself in. I get a kick out of it. I think you got to get a kick. I like it. I like that there's YouTubers walking around with massive arsenals of weaponry.
Yeah.
I think it's great. I enjoy it. I like that Nelk's out there blowing up people's cars in the middle of the road. I think it's good. I say, hey, look at the world and why not, right? Why wouldn't these things happen? I'm like, let's have a little fun. I mean, you can't breathe. There's no air quality. Everything's on fire all the time. Why would the city make any sense?
Right,
why would a place that shouldn't exist function in any way?
It's in a desert. There's no water here.
Yeah, you just got to get a kick out of it. These kids that are worth so much money, they walk into Boa Steakhouse, they've got sweatpants on.
Yep.
The staff has to explain to them what Brussels sprouts are. What a nightmare. The staff has to explain to a rapper with face tattoos who's on lean what, you know, au poivre sauce is. What a hell. And that person came to LA to be an actor. And they got to explain to a rapper who's mid overdose what au poivre sauce is. It's like you just got to enjoy. As a comedian, there's nothing else to do but enjoy it.
Yeah, that's a good point. What are you going to do in
Texas? I love it too.
I like LA.
What does it mean when you say I just throw myself in there? What does that look like? What do you do?
I mean, I just mentally prepare myself and I find the funny in it and I think it's all very funny. I think we're all lucky people to kind of do what we do out here and to have these kind of ridiculous jobs. And I think it's very, very funny. And I mean, Little Zan is a fan of my show. I think that's hilarious. I went.
Oh, we have sound bites of Little Zan.
I went to go see Little Zan because he texted me and goes, "Hey, I'm in Salt Lake City," and I went and I, you know, me and my fucking divorced dad Polo and stuff. I went to go see a Lil Xan show and I'm backstage with Lil Xan and it's just like, it's very funny. We look like some weird after school special where like a guy finds his little brother at school and he's like, "Who are you hanging out with?" Except it's reversed where the little brother is like a multimillionaire and wildly famous. It's just things like I laugh. I go, "This is great. This is funny. And this is great. Why not? Why not? What else? What else is going on?" I love New York, but people in New York, they're too self-important. Mm. Everything you do is important. Shut the fuck up.
That's how I felt in New York.
Yeah, it's too much.
Everyone minds their business, you know?
It's all so important and expensive and serious and like, I don't know,
yes.
Heavy.
Yeah, but I got really sick heavy. Of that. Because you know what? It's not, it seems like it is. I love New York. I'll always be a New Yorker, so you know, my voice and all that bullshit. But I'll tell you right now, I get a kick out. LA is just funnier. Right now, man,
that's very interesting to know because I feel like New York used to be the funny town,
yes,
the creative
it was,
town.
It's not anymore. I'm going to say it on H3H3.
Here
New
it
York is.
Is
not the funny town
you
anymore.
It
it's
here,
LA.
Woo-hoo.
Flip that, folks.
You know, there seems to be a mass exodus out of New York to LA. I know a ton of people right now, a ton of our employees from Teddy Fresh, which is Ela's clothing business, moved here.
I love
from
them.
New York.
They're my favorite people, the ex-New Yorkers.
They're good people because I think ex-New Yorkers are like, they got to soften that edge. So it's like, mm-hmm. You go to LA and it's like, cool, man. I dig LA. I love real estate. I walk around all these different neighborhoods.
Yeah.
I call realtors on the phone and just talk to them. I look up the block and those girls at Selling Sunset, you know, those.
Oh, I fucking
oh my
love
God.
And hate that show so much.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know that they sell homes, but they stand outside a lot and pose. And I think that's very important. And
Well, I've worked with agents and I always wonder what they do. So at least they do that.
Well, I don't know. Any agent we worked with looks nothing like that show.
Of course not.
They're sloppy old Jews, usually.
It's like when I, like, when I lay in bed at night and I imagine other jobs, it's I'm a high powered realtor. I'm a broker. Yeah, that's what I want to be. And I'm in shape and I get out and it's like there's all this sexual tension. I'm just showing the couple the house and it's like, yeah. Oh, you want to fuck me? Like, I feel like that's, you know, my,
like in reality,
like when I was in sales, I was just very bad at it. So I imagine I'm very, very bad at real estate as well.
That's funny.
In my head, I'm not. In my head, I'm great at it.
Yeah, I feel like real estate.
I think you're a little too angry to be a salesman.
Probably.
Yeah, that's a good observation, maybe, Ela. Okay, let me throw it to you. Speaking of LA, here we go. Ellen DeGeneres, how do we feel about her?
She's been around too long. She's been at the party too long. I mean, listen, I've said a lot of things about Ellen. I've called her murderer. I said she was in the CIA. Bygones. Water under the bridge, right? I said she tortures her interns and she should be in jail. Water under the bridge. I'm not holding these grudges. Maybe she is.
Yeah.
But I'll tell you this. She's a legend. She's a legend.
Right.
But you know what I mean? So is Bin Laden. Legends, you know, but Bin Laden, they took him out. She's been around for too long. If Bin Laden was still around, we'd be like, enough, Osama. But that's my point.
Do we need run a SEAL Team 6 on Ellen?
SEAL Team 6 has to go in and take her out because she'll never relinquish power.
Right,
she'll
that's true.
Relinquish control unless SEAL Team 6 sends in a mission to get her.
She is holding tighter than Saddam Hussein did. We're going to find her in a ditch.
She's so much tighter than Saddam. Fallon, chill, guys, I love you. Go. Hey, just step back a little bit. Otherwise, you're going to find everything you did, every blackface, everything. You've been famous for too long. Just recede and produce a movie or two. Like, you guys are creative. You're all fucking great. They're all incredibly talented people. But, at a certain point, it's just enough already. We get it.
Now, are you afraid maybe that you're going to be losing your opportunity to appear on Ellen, suggesting that SEAL Team 6 should assassinate her?
I got to be honest with you. I do believe that the door might be closed about me appearing now, but she doesn't have a lot of comedians on. She has these massive celebrities on. Because I think comedians would notice, like, hey, what's going on in the back?
Right.
So they might point that out. Where
Ellen, I
do like sloths.
Yeah. Ellen, I noticed one of your producers fingering somebody backstage when I was coming out here.
Right, right. Ellen, why is one of your interns strung up like Christ?
right.
That's to make a point.
Right.
I don't think I'll be on that.
Yeah, comedians are a little too open.
A little too open.
Well, she's good for apology tours if you ever get in trouble.
Yeah, right.
She's good for that, man. And she broke a lot of barriers for gay people. Mm-hmm. I appreciate that.
That's
right.
Yeah. She did definitely do that.
She's huge as a fucking like figure.
Yeah.
You know, in that world of people living honest lives in mainstream American society. That's huge. And I would always credit her for that.
Yeah.
But someone can do that and also have a lot of other things going on.
You know what I mean? I think you make a really good point how she holds on to power.
It's too long.
You know, is Jerry Springer still on TV? Because I know now, like, his security guard has taken the reins. Like, he had
like Steve Wilkos, right?
Steve, he has a fucking show. It's just bizarre to me. You know, I found that
out
recently.
I think Springer's off. I think that, like, you got, what is it, to die a hero or live long enough to see yourself become a villain? I think that's kind of what you're seeing with a lot of people. Like, if Oprah was still on TV every day, people would be like, enough.
Right.
I think you get a certain amount of time. And this is the hardest thing. This is the thing about LA. There's very few people aging gracefully here. There's very few people aging with dignity. It's hard to do because everybody wants to be the thing forever.
Right.
Everybody wants to hold on to the thing forever because it becomes their life force.
Mm-hmm. That's very true.
And I watch people and I watch when it starts to slip away, they ramp it up and they just want it. They double down and they dig in even harder. Mm-hmm. And it's tough, I think, right now because things are changing and moving so quickly and so rapidly. I think a lot of people just get caught up in this idea of like, I'm going to be around forever. I don't think that's the climate right now. I don't think the climate right now is to be.
I don't think the world's going to be around much longer.
In the zeitgeist forever is tough.
Okay. What about Bill Gates?
Gates is an interesting guy, right? So Gates and me and Rogan kind of went we argued about this a little bit, because I'm not saying Bill Gates created AIDS. I'm not one of these Looney Tunes. Here's what I'm saying about Bill Gates.
Outlandish.
Bill Gates is a billionaire. Great. Good for him. Brilliant guy. Whatever. But he has a huge impact on American or potentially a massive impact on society, American society. By the way, so does Jeff Bezos.
Yeah.
So do all of these people, right? These are Batman villain billionaire types. And I don't mean that they're all evil. I mean that they have this massive war chest of money to spend. The Kochs, all of these guys, right? Soros, Sheldon Adelson. I mean, just go through the list of people. I would just be comfortable, a little more comfortable with a little scrutiny so that we don't start adopt. I don't think we should live in a society where one person, however progressive or however informed they may be, although this is a tech guy who's really interested himself in public health, which is fine. But that is also people are in their own heads going, why is a guy whose primary expertise technology very is certain and sure about the course we need to take in terms of vaccinations and health? And there's probably good reasons for that. I don't think him and his wife are monsters. I don't know him and his wife. I don't know what him and his wife believe. I'm deeply uncomfortable with people that are trying to remake or reimagine society and are truly resistant to any type of criticism. I think if you throw yourself in the ring, you throw your hat in the ring, you should accept good faith criticism of your ideas and what you're trying to do. And I don't know that he's that person. And I don't know that there's been enough discussion about things he wants to do or things that he thinks is appropriate. I mean, famously, I talked about it on my show. He wanted to shoot like a missile of dust into the atmosphere to help climate change. And a bunch of scientists were like, that's a really bad idea.
Missile of dust.
They didn't do it. But here's the thing. How many people in history have had the resources to even have that thought?
It's crazy because, you know, he's not a body of government. There's not checks and balances on Bill Gates. He's so rich. He has the resources of a small country without any oversight. The fact, you're right, that he can just shoot a missile of dust and just
be
like, let's see.
Thought, and I think Bezos, the same
Bezos
thing.
Has so much money. He doesn't know what to fucking do with it. He's just shooting shit into space because he's got nothing else to spend money.
Right. So I just think that we should just,
is that un-American though, to be like, Bezos, let's take a look. Let's see what you're doing with all that cash.
I don't think it's un-American to do that. I think
it's important to remember that if someone is good at one thing, it doesn't mean they're going to be good at everything. And the problem is, I think another problem is that how many people around these billionaires can really criticize them? Like, do they even have anyone in their life that criticizes them?
Nah.
They're a billionaire. Like,
maybe, but we as Americans have this tendency to fetishize people that are that successful as like almost like demigods and feel like they're infallible because they're so successful. And you're like, Bill Gates is going to shoot a missile of dust into space. Cool. He must have checked that out. And that seems
Maybe I don't know what the COVID vaccine is going to look like. I'm not an anti-vaxxer. I'm not any of that. I just know that I'm not excited to get the first round of COVID vaccines. I don't know anyone who is. I don't know anyone who's excited to show up at a Walgreens and just get a needle put in them for the first round. Like, I think that there's people that are going to want to say, I want to take my chance with this. I don't want to synthetically inject something unless it's very safe.
I think we're down to take whatever.
If it goes through all the proper channels,
right?
You know, and the fucking whatever, FDC.
FDA, probably Food and Drug, maybe.
Yeah,
I don't know.
One of those Fs, one of those cocksuckers. Anyway, once they approve it, I'll take that shit right in my neck.
I agree. If it's approved, I agree with you 110%. I just don't
But
want,
if Trump's like hey, the vaccine's here on November 2nd, isn't that great?
Isn't that great? Yeah. And you can't win at the voting place.
Free vaccine with every vote for Trump.
I don't think I've ever gotten a flu booster. I've never gotten the flu. I don't know. I gotta tell you,
I did when I was pregnant.
Because
they're like, you should take it when you're pregnant.
Right.
And I didn't get sick, and I was like,
No, the flu shot
is great. I think the shot actually worked.
The thing is, it's not 100% effective.
I've never gotten like the boosters on. I don't go in every year for it.
Yeah, you need it every year. But mostly you only need it if you're like,
that's a lot of work.
Or if you're old or some shit.
I have AIDS and I'm old, but I just.
You should get it then.
My whole thing with all that stuff is like, we don't talk anything about immune health in this country. We don't say anything about diet. We don't say anything about stress. We don't say, because God forbid somebody not work 15 hours.
Yes, stress. God forbid
everybody's not at home watching Gary Vee learning how to start their own empire. It's like, well, we don't talk about any of that. We don't talk about sleep or stress or mental health. We have none of it. And then it's just the answers in this country are always pharmaceutical companies, and they're always people standing to make billions of dollars. It's always, let's medicate, medicate, medicate. You're depressed, you're anxious, you're this. Not you're maybe living a life without honesty. You're not doing things in a healthy way. There's no holistic approach to health ever in this country. And if you go to other countries, that's not the case. Like if you go to other countries, they're actually much more holistic in their approach to treating things. And you know, I was talking to a really brilliant comedian who I won't say his name, Louis C.K. I'll say it was Louis C.K. Louis C.K. made a great point. He was dating somebody who I was talking to him. He was dating.
You know Louis C.K.?
Yeah, he was dating a woman who lived in Paris
or
France, and they were in a hospital and she was really sick. And the doctor was basically like, Louis goes, oh my God, she could die. And the doctor was like, yes, she could die. And then Louis had this realization. He's like, oh yeah, that's the difference. Like in America, everything's about beating death at all costs, at any cost. It's a game of numbers. You're not dying. We don't care if we send you out of the hospital with no legs in a wheelchair and whatever. We're beating it.
You're going on the whiteboard in a vegetative state.
Exactly. And in France and places like that, they're like, yeah, that's a part of life. It absolutely could happen.
I think it's the Christian thing a little bit. Because like I was listening to the hearings on the new Supreme Court nominee, and they go from inception to natural death. It's like they don't believe that people should be able to die.
Well, that's crazy. And that's like, one of the crazy.
It's like you can never pull the plug. Vegetative state.
That's crazy. If somebody has like a tumor and they want to get out of here before it gets bad.
No, you can't.
I think anyone standing in the way of that is crazy. Oh, God. And does Amy Coney Barrett, she doesn't believe in assisted death?
No, no. God. Absolutely not.
This is a problem. This is why this is a problem.
Yeah, that's a problem.
You know, it's like, who are you to tell an 80-year-old with brain cancer that he can't fucking end it and not ruin his family's life, you know?
Right. Yeah. I mean, that's crazy.
Okay.
I don't think he'll get confirmed. I think it's very possible if he does not win, she's not going to get confirmed.
Really? I feel like it's inevitable. I don't know how the Democrats can even block because they have the Senate.
Well, they might not block it. I mean, it may be inevitable. We'll see. I don't know. I mean, it's
a little scary for me because she is like, she's straight up handmaiden tale.
Yeah.
Level. They can overturn gay marriage and abortion and that's fucking like the thought of making gay marriage illegal again is like so medieval.
It's medieval.
It's hard to imagine.
I don't think abortion would be made illegal again. I don't know why Roe would come back in front of the court. There is a precedent, it's a legal precedent. I mean, it's not like a Brown versus Board of Education or Marbury versus Madison, one of these ironclad cases that would never be heard again. There is a possibility that Roe would be maybe heard again. But I don't know. I don't think Kavanaugh would vote for, I don't think they have the votes to overturn Roe on the court. I think it is a massive seismic issue. I don't think they have the votes for it.
If she wins.
Yeah, I don't know if they'd have the vote. I don't see them overturning gay marriage either. I mean, I know that these are possibilities and they're disturbing.
I hope not. Yeah, I hope not.
I don't want them to happen.
Yeah.
I just don't know if those things will happen. I think really a lot of what the Supreme Court does, which nobody talks about, is a lot of these guys are just kind of like, you know, they just kind of, you know, pave the way for a lot of laws that hurt workers or people that need help.
They're very, all these conservative appointees are all very pro corporate and they oil the cogs for sure.
Yeah, 100%. And I think this, you know, very divided public space you have right now, where like no one's really in either camp unless you're on Twitter. Like most people are in the middle to some degree and they don't really know which way they are. But I don't know too many people under the age of 40 that are really trying to get gay marriage overturned or trying to get Roe v. Wade overturned. It does seem more generational. I think younger people don't care about that stuff nearly as much.
Yeah. It does bum me out though, that you have someone who's so outside the representation of the average American who's so young. She's like, what, 45 or something?
She's definitely young.
She's super young. She's like, Like, she's like Mike Pence level conservative. It's like, these are people that you almost would never even meet. It's like, oh, you're one of those aberrations. Like,
there's two things. Number one, she's gonna serve for life. Like, she's got a lot of kids. She is a family person.
Dude. She's got seven kids.
Seven kids.
But wow. I do think there's a lot of people in America that are religious, that have a lot of kids, that have similar values to her. I don't know how far into the mainstream she is. I think overturning Roe v. Wade is out of the mainstream, right? The idea and that's out of the mainstream. The idea of it would still go back to the states. States would put restrictions on it or whatever. That's out of the mainstream. I think her, she's probably like a mom that is loves children and loves her family.
No, but that's not an excuse. I'm a mom, and I would not feel comfortable living in a place where abortion is illegal.
Yeah.
I don't think I will live in a place that abortion is illegal.
But Ela made a good point.
I've been through it, and that is not something you can force. No, I've been through pregnancy.
I was like,
that's not something you can force someone to go through. If you're not ready for it, and if you're not ready to have a kid, why would you? It's such a life decision.
A lot of people disagree with you because
it's
murder.
It's not murder if you do it at the right time. No one is saying do abortion the day before birth.
Well,
which
they lie. They keep saying that's what people want to do.
No one is saying that. That is obviously way too late.
Well, actually, you could, in very rare circumstances, get a late term abortion if it's going to threaten the life of the mom or the baby.
Well, that should be like a medical situation. That should be up to the doctor.
They play it up like they say,
yeah,
Gavin Newsom wants to kill babies the day before they're born. Yeah. But like, that's obviously in an extremely rare case where the baby is probably...
I just think it's a law that's been in place since 1965. I don't think it'll be overturned. I think I think that a lot of the people that have a lot of power in this country love these issues because they divide people. They get people arguing. But I think there's a lot of things going on that are much more important because I don't know how that even happens. I don't know how Roe gets overturned. I mean, I'm sure that smarter people that hear me on the show are going to go, here's how it happens. I'm going to be like, thank you. You know, as I'm eating a, you know, I'll look at it and be like, thank you. That does make sense. But I hope it doesn't happen. Amy Coney Island, whatever her name is, Coney Barrett,
exactly.
Hot dog lady. I call her the hot dog woman.
Yeah.
She's God love her. I mean, she's an accomplished woman. She's got Haitian kids. I'm all for that. Whatever she wants to do.
Haitian kids?
She adopted kids from Haiti. I think that's cool.
That is very cool.
That's nice. And, she's probably a good person. I mean, you know what, man? We just live in a country where there are people just have radically different ideas about what should happen. I'm always I'm into freedom. I'm like, I want people to have the freedom to do what they want to do. Doesn't bother me. The idea of like, you want to take your kids to hear drag queens read stories at the library? Great. You don't? Great. You want to have an abortion? Great. You don't want to do that? Don't do it. Like this idea that we need this, that everyone needs to believe that. I've never needed to believe the same things as anyone else, and I wouldn't expect to. So I think part of the problem right now is that everybody needs this one size fits all policy. It's like, if you're morally opposed to abortion, I totally understand that. Don't have one.
Okay, so do you have a favorite billionaire and a least favorite billionaire?
Interesting, great question. The Saudi royal family, they're just they're just fun. I like they have an indoor water park where they ride jet skis. I've always thought beheadings were hilarious.
Right.
Beheadings are very funny. Behandings are funny. It's just funny to be hand or behead. Again, wrong, but it's just funny. It's funny to have all the creature comforts and all the progressive modern things and go like, yeah, but I still want to whack off. I still want to get a head out of here. I still want to take someone's hand off in the middle of the day. Even though you've got it all, you've got the internet, you know it's not right, right? You know it's a barbaric practice, but you go, I really just, for my own purposes, I just like to, fillet people and stuff. So the Saudis are my favorites because they're kooky. Yeah. And I like kooky people. They're fun, right? And then my least favorite billionaire, I'm trying to think my least favorite billionaire. Least favorite billionaire. So George Soros, and not for the reason people think, not because I think he could cause a conspiracy. I'm just annoyed with hearing his name. I think his name is ruined. It's tainted legitimate conspiracies. Like, it's George Soros, you should be able to criticize people that are doing wacky things without going, and they're being funded by George Soros. I'm just so sick of hearing his name. Because I don't know much about, I know enough about him to know that, like, I'm sure he wants to do things I don't agree with, and I'm sure he puts money behind it. But, like, the idea that everybody in this country that's rioting or looting or protesting or whatever is somehow funded by George Soros is hilarious. And so I would say he's my least favorite, because it's just, he's become this totemic symbol to people, and it's annoying. And I would say the Saudi royal family is just my favorite because they're just fun. I like good family. Yeah. Yeah.
Family fun. I like that. What do you think about QAnon?
So it's a crazy thing, but it has nuggets of truth. Human trafficking is a major problem. There have been many cover-ups involving very wealthy, powerful people, both political figures and politically connected people. It is something where there's a lot of effort put in sweeping those things under the rug, a la Jeffrey Epstein. Mm-hmm. So there are nuggets of truth here. But
Hillary, so there's two more subjects I want to ask you about.
Yes.
Hillary Clinton.
You know, answer is, yeah. You know, badass bitch. Listen, Hillary is as she's a tough as nails person. She's incredibly immoral. She has a lust for power that's, is unquenchable. She is a notorious backroom dealer, very good at it, never been a good campaigner, always good in back rooms, making deals in Congress, you know, the Senate. People really respected her. Never met a war she didn't like, never met a bank she didn't want to do business with. It's all about a lust for power. I think that whatever idealism she had at Yale in the 60s or whatever, you know, has just been stomped out of her. I mean, her and her husband are... Dick Morris wrote that book about them, Partners in Power. I think she full well knew that he had problems with women and the way that he treated women. I think she supported him. She, I think, attacked those women. She aligned people that legitimately accused her husband of horrible acts and things like rape. I put nothing past her. I mean, I joke around in my act. I say, like, she's killed people or whatever. I don't know that she has or not. I don't put much past her. I don't. I mean, I think people who compartmentalize their life to that degree. And I know, like, that's not only politicians, right? There's a lot of people in power positions that have secret families, secrets they hide from people wherever, like people that compartmentalize your life to that degree. I mean, what those people can be capable of in the pursuit of something that they feel is the greater good, which is their power. You know, I don't know what she's involved with or who she's involved with. I just know that she's very comfortable talking to dictators and despots. You know, she laughed hysterically when Muammar Gaddafi was sodomized to death on camera. And Muammar Gaddafi is not a great guy, but she's like cackling in the background. So this is not someone
is that I don't.
Yeah, it's true. Wow. Yeah.
Was that like a war room situation? What was that?
I don't know exactly, but this is somebody who she made some very, very funny, like not very funny, but like fun offhanded comments while, you know, he was just like attacked in the street, and like murdered in a very heinous way.
Yeah.
And that doesn't faze her. She's unfazed. I mean, she joked about droning Julian Assange, right?
Not, that's true. She did do that.
Yeah, I mean, she's unfazed by things true. That would faze most of us, right?
That's true.
Most people are like, hey, what about that? No, it's all true. It's all verifiable. Everything I say is true.
Yeah.
Every time I say something on Joe's show,
we're fact-checking you live, and we haven't found one issue yet.
They're all true. Yeah. I mean, they're all true. I mean, to the extent that... Listen, maybe I would have let. Maybe she was uncomfortable and she was like, yeah, I don't know, but
probably not.
It's a little scary when someone like that, when somebody like that wants power and thinks they deserve it, it's a little terrifying. So she scares me, but also I think she's also a great, in the same way, I think it's a great victory for feminism.
Hang on, I have a clip here. I've not seen this. Hillary Clinton laughs about killing, Gaddafi. Let's see.
So, I mean, that is the land of unconfirmed.
Yes, we came, we saw, he died.
Yeah, that's pretty callous. That's pretty weird. That's pretty callous, eh?
But this is, a, I mean, this and is, like, if you go research how he died, I mean, how he died.
It was, it was just brutal.
And she knows exactly how he died. Yeah. So this is a woman that these morons on Twitter are saying, I'm still with her and what a great victory for women. It's such an optics, you know, aesthetic, ceremonial thing, whereas this woman is a deeply troubling figure that is, you know, historically will be understood as much more of a villain than she is now. I think when all is said and done, and when the history books are written, she will go down in history as someone who has many villainous qualities.
Yeah, you would think if you were involved in someone dying, you would probably need some therapy, some kind of quiet moments. But
I get that people like her have to make big decisions, and people, you know, people have to, I understand that's a life and death thing. There's a certain level of callousness.
That's true.
And listen, it's not only that, right? It's a pattern of behavior. It's attacking women that have accused your husband of rape. It's doing all of these things. And then when you put that all together, you have it's floating a picture of Barack Obama dressed in traditional African garb and saying he's a Muslim when you're running against the primaries for him and like potentially endangering his family.
She did that?
Yeah, our campaign did it. When they float stuff like that, when you float stuff like that in a country where people react violently to things like that, you know,
she did that shit. I didn't know she did that.
Yeah.
I mean, this is.
Can you pull up that picture? I want to see. I'm getting educated on Hillary Clinton.
The whole birtherism thing started with Hillary's campaign.
No. 2008. Dan is. Can you hear Dan? He's saying birtherism started with Hillary.
Dan knows.
It's true.
Wow. What a bitch.
It's what when you want
power. Because I despise the birtherism thing. That to me is like one of the most despicable fucking acts of, you know, just one of the trashiest things, really.
I mean, this is a couple that presided over a crime bill that was incredibly damaging to minority communities that, you know, prosecuted an unjust, unfair drug war in those areas or continued to attack women that had legitimate you know, accusations against her husband. I mean, these are people that it's a perfect example of the 60s kind of progressivism getting turned in a very ugly way. I mean, you know, in the 90s and kind of this very interesting, they're fascinating people. And I would never say that they weren't this great American story in the same way that the Bushes are this very interesting dynasty. And I mean, it's all very interesting, but I think as history, they will not be remembered kindly in history, my guess.
I'm waking up, dude. Well, I, for one, will be writing in Jeffrey Epstein. And I hope you will be joining me.
I'll be right. You write in Jeffrey, I'll write in Ghislaine.
Yeah, perfect. The perfect. The new energy we need in this country to govern.
Yeah. Can I write in, by the way? Because I will do that just for an Instagram post.
Oh, my God. People will be so angry at you.
Vote doesn't really matter. It's California.
That's true. Write in Jeffrey Epstein. Let's see what happens.
I kind of want to write in Maxwell because she's still alive.
Right.
Kind of funny. I'm going to ask when I go to the polling place, I'm going to go, listen, I want to do a bit. Can I have an extra ballot?
Oh, my God.
I decided I'm going to vote twice, too, just because it's too important of an election. All right, dude. Thanks for coming on.
Thanks so much for having me, guys.
Everything you're
thanks
doing.
For coming on.
You guys, thank you. Good. I appreciate it. See you soon.
See you soon. Right, bye. Bye.